The government's released its 2023 budget, which it hopes will deal with the bread and butter issues being faced by Kiwis. Parents with youngsters should be pleased with 20 hours free early childhood education now extended to two-year-olds from next year. It comes at a cost of $1.2 billion. Elsewhere, the $5 prescription fee for your medicine from pharmacies is being scrapped. That'll cost $620 million. This comes into effect in July. Bus, train and ferry trips will also be cheaper for youngsters. Fares will be free for children under 13 and half price for those under the age of 25. That costs $330 million. And less expensive energy bills. A $400 million injection is expected to result in 100,000 homes retrofitted with heating and insulation. But it's a slimmed down spend up compared to previous budgets, with the big promise it puts us on the right economic path. Finance Minister Grant Robertson joins us now from Wellington. Good morning, Minister. With all the promises in that budget of no recession coming, we're going to get inflation down between 1% and 3%, you paint a pretty rosy picture, so why was the spend up so mean?
Oh, look, we've got to get a balance here. And obviously, as you noted yourself, we've had some pretty big spending budgets where we got through COVID together and did the wage subsidy and those things that I know people really appreciated. But now we've got to get a balance between easing those cost of living pressures where we can, alongside bringing ourselves back to a more sustainable fiscal position. And, you know, I think New Zealanders will appreciate this is what really what they're going through in their own households at the moment. There's lots of reasons to be optimistic about the future, but 2023 is a challenging year and it requires a budget with the kind of balance that we've put out yesterday.
How does this budget put food on the table or pay the power bill?
So on the 1st of April this year, we saw reasonably substantial increases for things like superannuation, students, main benefits, family tax credits. So that money's gone in, obviously building on what we've previously done. What it does do is ease pressure. So rather than, you know, a tax cut, which would have a big inflationary impact, what we've done is we've targeted early childhood education, the prescriptions, public transport, and said, here are costs that we know families have got. We can take a little bit of that pressure off, which allows them to think about, for example, you know, their food budget for the week or so on. So definitely understanding that we've got to ease that cost of living pressure, but we have to balance that up with not making inflation worse, which is the problem we're all trying to solve.
You've just noted people are thinking about their food budget, though, and I think a lot of people would have been hoping we would finally get to the point where we could have GST off fruit and vegetables. There's nothing that directly addresses housing costs there. There's not even any pay parity for GP nurses. I mean, no new big spending in health.
Well, there is big new spending in health. What we did in the last budget was allocate 2 years of health funding to allow
in the last budget, Health New Zealand, not this and, budget.
No. Anna, listen carefully to the answer. Sorry, I was only halfway through it. There were 2 years' worth of funding in the last budget. There's $1.3 billion of new funding for health in this budget. And what that does is allow the new Health New Zealand and Te Aku Whai Ora, the Māori Health Authority, to get on with doing things like reducing waiting lists and making sure that we get kids immunised. So the big spending on health is carrying on. All we did was make sure that we could plan better with that money last year. But in terms of your overall point, there are always going to be parts of our economy and our society that we can't reach in each individual budget. You have to see them across a series of budgets. I think we've done pretty well over the last few years to support New Zealanders through COVID, to ease that cost of living pressure. Now we've also got to do another thing at the same time, which is bring government spending back down to more normal levels so we don't make inflation worse.
And analysts have sort of given it an okay pass in terms of it is a fairly reserved forward-looking budget, but that it looks at the short term and not the long term. How do you respond to that?
Yeah, look, I think we've tried to find a balance there. We obviously are doing short-term things with those cost of living measures that we've taken, but equally we've got a significant commitment to infrastructure spending, you know, the roads and the rail, the houses, the hospitals that we need to build the recovery from the cyclone. That money gets spent over a period of time, but the message we've heard really clearly from the construction sector is give us certainty, tell us what's coming. And so that's why we've got that big commitment to spend there. You know, people shouldn't underestimate the scale of this recovery from the cyclone. It's the second biggest natural disaster or weather event New Zealand's ever had, somewhere between $9 and $14 billion over the next few years. The government's got to step up to pay its share of that. I don't think your viewers would want us to step back from supporting the people affected by the cyclone, and so we've had to deal with that. That's where that big infrastructure, that long-term view comes in.
And yet you're giving businesses recovering from the cyclone the same amount of money you're giving the gaming industry.
Yeah, well, I mean, the gaming industry is an important industry. It's the kind of jobs I think we want to see created in New Zealand. You know, these are the high-tech, high-wage jobs. Low emissions don't have such an impact on climate change. And we want to encourage that. If we want that sector, we've got to step up with this kind of payment. The Australians are doing it, and our talent has been leaving New Zealand and going to Australia. Right around New Zealand, there are amazing people doing game development. This is a contribution that we can make. In terms of what we're doing for the whole of the cyclone affected regions, it's about $1.6 billion already committed there. So I think that's a pretty good effort.
But for people looking at that budget breakdown, will they really care about seeing money going to the gaming industry when they're telling you they can't afford the groceries, they can't pay the power bill, and the best they got was maybe $5 off a script if they get sick?
It's a balance. We've got to be able to ease cost of living pressures. We've targeted that so it doesn't increase inflation. On the other side of the coin, I wouldn't want to put a budget together that didn't look a little bit to the future, the kinds of jobs that are going to keep people in New Zealand. We've also got investments in our science sector there to be able to, you know, really solve the big problems of the world and sell those ideas to the world as well. You know, you have to have a vision of a better tomorrow as well as dealing with today, and that's the balance we've tried to strike here.
You talk about looking to the future. Kāinga Ora only got a one-year extension to its funding. More than 500,000 households in this country rely on an accommodation supplement or a housing grant. Where's the long-term strategy?
Well, in terms of the accommodation supplement and housing grant, that's already baked in. The 1 year's worth of funding was about the building of new public houses. We've committed to that. Obviously, we've got an election campaign to come where we might be able to say a bit more about that. But in terms of, you know, balancing a huge number of state houses that we've already built, more than 10,000 over the time we've been in government. We've added another 3,000 to that in this budget. Got to bear in mind the capacity of the sector alongside all of the other construction work going on. But, you know, our commitment to state housing is absolutely resolute, and I think we've done a pretty good job of it, actually, over the last few years.
It was fair to say, though, Megan Woods didn't have a great answer for it yesterday when asked about it in the lock-up, was that she said it was something all political parties needed to consider. It seems that there is a gap there, the whole spectrum. New Zealand has some of the highest rents and some of the fewest new-build houses, and we don't seem to have a strategy for how we're going to tackle that.
One in seven of the state houses that we have in total have been built by our government. And when you think about the housing program goes back to 1938, that's a pretty impressive effort. We have kept building state houses coming into government when the previous government had been selling them off. We've got a commitment to another 3,000 in this budget. But as Minister Woods was saying yesterday, as we look ahead to future years, we get to the election campaign and all parties will then make their commitment at that stage. For us, I think our track record on state housing stacks up and people can see what we've been able to do.
The problem is, though, is that we have a housing crisis in this country, and part of that is because we have expensive rents and it's really expensive to buy your own home. Wouldn't a capital gains tax, although it would depress housing values to an extent, it would go some way to solving the issue that we have. It's cyclical. We have had it for years.
A huge part of that supply and demand, and we just simply over the recent years have not built the houses we needed. You know, New Zealand's population grew significantly over the last decade or so, and we just weren't building the houses we needed to keep up. We've stepped up, we're doing our bit within that regard. We are seeing our housing supply increase. And actually in terms of rents, you know, although they have increased, they've actually increased slightly lower than the rate of inflation over the last few years. That's because there is a greater supply of rental properties coming in. So absolutely, there'll be a debate about tax in the election campaign, about what the appropriate measures are. We brought in, extended the Bright Line test out a couple of years ago to try and say, well, actually, if you're going to flip properties, you will pay for that. But I think it's actually the building of houses that will make a massive difference here. When it comes to those big tax policies, that really will be a campaign issue.
Finance Minister Grant Robertson, thank you very much for your time this morning.
Thanks, Anna. Cheers.